Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Today, we'll be looking at art and optical science with specific reference to a very different kind of art movement that took place around 1950s and 60s in Europe and in America called Pop Art Movement. Now, Pop Art as a movement was driven by artists who were interested in investigating various perceptual techniques. And it is in this connection that they were looking at the recent developments in optical science and the science of perception. And they were also looking at how our brain, our perception is continuously kind of misguided and misled by the various operational factors. And they were also trying to find out whether it was possible to address these issues of optical science in their own art. So, some of these artists, they did it out of pure enthusiasm for research and experiment, because of art movement gave birth to a number of artworks which were basically experimental in nature. In the sense that because it is once again absolutely abstract and non-referential in nature, because it was based on purely non-representational elements like lines, shapes, and very subtle movements of lines, patterns, so on and so forth, hence an artist working along the ideas of pop art had to experiment a lot and go through a rigorous process before arriving at a satisfying work of art. Now, there were also artists who got engaged with pop art movement with a distant hope that the effects they mastered might find a wide public acceptance and hence integrate modern art into society in new ways. So, that was one of the hopes on part of these artists, because pop art, when you look at examples, for example like this, an example of an pop art painting by one of the pioneers of this movement called Victor Vassarelli. Now, Victor Vassarelli was doing this kind of paintings, and many others, basically addressing the perceptual effects, the optical effects of visual movements, of visual patterns on our eyes, on our perception. And this is something that anybody could understand. This is something that anybody could actually appreciate. Because these paintings do not have a major conceptual or philosophical content or theory. These paintings, in order to appreciate these paintings, you really do not need a philosophical knowledge about these paintings. What you need to do is to simply integrate what you see, that is optical illusions happening continuously on the canvas, on the surface, painted surface that you are looking at. Victor Vassarelli, then followed by Bridget Riley, another extremely sincere, engaged artist belonging to the op art movement. And both of them and many others, they kept on producing some mind-boggling paintings which represent the op art movement. Now, pop art paintings, when you go examples one after the other, can be seen as an extension of abstract images. As I have already mentioned, because they are also altogether non-representational and non-referential, without having anything to do with the real objective experiential world. But on the other hand, they cannot be simply seen as an extension of abstract painting, mainly because they access something that originally belonged to the realm of science, optical science, not to the realm of the language of art, not to the realm of the philosophical quest through abstract art, as we have seen that in abstract expressionist movement, or as we have seen previously in previous art movements. However, the style we now know as art style emerged from the work of Victor Vassarelli, who first explored unusual perceptual effects in some designs from the 1930s onwards. It was given a further boost by the group show at Lay movement at Galerie Denis René in Paris in 1955, and later by a series of international exhibitions exploring what was known for the time as the new tendency. So the term of art came into being slightly later. Initially, it was seen as a new tendency in painting and also in sculpture to a small extent, where the artists were primarily trying to create extremely complex and difficult optical illusions and optical effects through their works of art. And that was their objective, that was their motto, that was what they were trying to achieve. Vassarelli's work soon attracted followers across the world. And now you have Bridget Riddle, whose works we just saw, who, like Vassarelli, had already worked in advertising and took up the style, and soon achieving even more prominence than Vassarelli. And many South American artists, mainly residing in Paris, also worked in op mode. So op was a movement, certainly, but it was also a tendency. It was also a mode of painting that caught the imagination of many artists across the continent, many artists across the United States of America in 1950s, in 1960s. In fact, the pinnacle of the movement's success was in 1965, when the Museum of Modern Art embraced the style with the exhibition called The Responsive Eye, which showcased 123 paintings and sculptures by artists such as Victor Vassarelli, Bridget Riddle, Frank Stella, Carlos Ruiz, Jesus Rafael Soto, Joseph Albers, and many others. Many museum attendees were intrigued by the collision of art and optical science. So it was a collision, it was a new kind of amalgamation of theories of optical science with art. So art was basically making those optical science theories manifest in a variety of ways. And it was also, in a sense, very engaging for the viewers, because what they were looking at, once again, was not a story, not a narrative, not a description, but a happening, as it were, taking place right in front of you of the canvas that you're looking at. However, art movement faced serious criticism as well regarding their plausibility as serious art, because of art did not have any deep, profound, conceptual content or idea. And that is why some of the art critics thought it was a passing phase, it was a shallow kind of art movement. But really speaking, and before we get into this criticism, we must also admit the fact that these artists belonging to the art movement had put tremendous effort and a huge amount of intelligence, mind, time, and also microscope, new ideas which were significant or relevant not only to the art movement only, but it definitely, and it did, create a great impact on the succeeding developments in art. When we look at contemporary art scenario today, of course there is nothing called pop art as such today, but we do come across several such tendencies happening right now across the world where pop art mode has been adopted or incorporated to express maybe something different. However, pop art movement faced serious criticism regarding their proximity to serious art, but many critics considered this trend as merely optical and nothing conceptual or philosophical in content. But that did not discourage this movement or the artists belonging to this movement at all. They carried on with their experiences. Now, maybe there is a monotony when you look at several examples of art. But it is very interesting also to take note of the slight variations and the differences that these pop artists were trying to create in each and every work. Through different movements in the patterns, different directions in the lines, and of course, the optical effects, the intended optical effects in these paintings are often very different from one another. Now, pop art also has this expectation, let me say, from the viewers, that viewers need to tune their eyes and mind in a certain way to let the perceptual effect leave some impact on your mind. So, pop art demands a certain engagement on part of the viewers. It is not simply just to be looked at, but one has to be very keen on the effect each and every of our painting is trying to create on your eye. One has discovered that. So, when you look at a painting like this by Bridget Reilly, and when you see the very, very subtle, subtle waves running across the painting and creating certain sensations on your eye, you know that what you're looking at is a flat piece of canvas. But the effect is unfolding, as it were, in time. So this is an illusion, an optical illusion that is being generated through a certain arrangement of the patterns and directions on the canvas. So definitely these are discoveries coming up from optical science researchers. But look at the wonderful ways in which artists like Prof. Soumik and Bridget Reilly are utilizing these discoveries of optical science in different ways. Now look at this painting by Prof. Soumik. Again, it is an effect of optical science or a perceptual kind of game that is played upon our brain while looking at the canvas. So, the illusion of sphere that you get in this painting is a complete illusion. It is something that is not factually true. After all, the canvas is flat, dead flat. But by applying certain perceptual patterns and ideas and certain kinds of arrangements, Victor Vassilini is able to create certain illusion which is actually not so much a pictorial illusion which was invented during the Renaissance time, but it has got more to do with the optical illusion in connection to the discovery of optical science. Then somebody like Joseph Albers, who would go on years after years researching on the relationship between various shades of almost the same color, various tones of the same color, but in terms of squares and rectangles. So, though in his paintings, Joseph Albers do not apply any kind of color perspective or even linear perspective. But once again, he is playing with the possibilities of optical illusion, that when you paint these squares using certain gradations of tones of almost the same color or similar color, you do not create literally the depth in the canvas, but a certain recession of space is created on our mind. Our brain tends to read the differences in the tones in terms of distance, though it is not intended by the painter. So, Joseph Albers, in fact, had a whole series of paintings done in the 1960s, and he called them Homage to the Square. Taking up a single motif, like very, very simple motif at square, he does paintings after paintings, addressing the very existence of squares and the magic of the squares in different tones can play on our brain. One more painting by Joseph Albers. Here, of course, the squares have different colors, but again, the colors have been chosen very carefully. The colors have been juxtaposed also very carefully, just to create an exceptional kind of space, a spatial experience, only through squares and its colors, with an otherwise a very minimalist approach, with no other association, with no other prints. This is one more work by Joseph Albers, having a slightly different theme, because here he is not working with squares, he is working with horizontal lines with slight shifts in the positions, and definitely with varying degrees of tones and shades of the same color. And the effect is for us to see what is happening after this kind of application. Joseph Albers calls his painting Park, painted in 1924. To what extent this painting has a relationship with the experience of the real park in our neighborhood, it's not very clear. It is possible, of course, that a park, or looking at a park from a top floor, might have figured out a pictorial idea that Albers gradually transformed into this particular pictorial image. One more example from the Homage to the Square series by Joseph Albers. So when you look at many such examples from this series called The Homage to the Square by Joseph Albers, in the first glimpse, the paintings may appear to be the same composition but with slightly different colors. But then, one has to be very sensitive and responsive to the changes in the colors and the tones, because despite the fact that the scale, size, and shape of the squares remain almost the same in each and every painting, because of the changes in the tones and changes in the colors, the effect between the squares and the effect of the juxtaposition of the squares on our mind keeps changing drastically from one painting to another. In order to understand this, we just need to give time to this painting, keep looking at it, and find out yourself that why it is not exactly the same painting. Why they are to be treated as paintings with slightly different impact on our optical perception. One more painting by Albers, which he calls Glass. Now, this is a sculpture, interestingly. A sculpture which is a flat sculpture but creates a huge amount of illusion of depth and creates things and the illusion of solidity, volume. So, this is one example which goes to show and suggests that all art was not confined to painting only. There were sculptors who were also making sculptures with a similar idea of creating optical illusion, following the laws and discoveries of optical science and its perceptual effects on our mind and brain. And interestingly, this is why the same painter, Victor Vasarely, now, of art got extended. I mean, of art did not end with the end of the movement itself. It is true that till today, as I have already mentioned, we see extensions of art, new definitions of art happening even amongst the young generation of artists. And there are quite a few artists across the world who are reclaiming the position of art. Art can be seen applied, or the trends of art can be seen applied to commercial art, artistic art, interior decor, and many other such spaces where this kind of optical impact has a great presence in a public sphere. These are the patterns that we might have come across in our science books. But at the same time, it is true. This is the kind of imagery that many of the artists belonging to the art movement were trying to create. Now, we have one interesting example, a very exceptional, I would say, example of an artist called, a Dutch artist called M.C. Escher, who lived once again. Because he was born in 1898, so he is a 20th century artist who carried on with the experiments of optical art and took it to an extraordinary innovative level by infusing recognizable elements, representational elements in his drawings, paintings, and graphic paintings. Now, in that sense, it's very different because all artists belonging to the all art movement were strictly confined to abstract patterns. But Esther, on the other hand, is making very representational works where each and every object can be easily recognizable. But what is very difficult to fathom and accept in his works is the kind of difficulty, the kind of impossibility that he is creating by using once again the paradoxes of optical. optical arc. The paradoxes of optical science. So, Asher keeps on creating extremely difficult and impossible constructions like this. In terms of the picture making, it is logically possible, but because it is representational art, when you apply these visions to the real world, you know that it is impossible. It is impossible to ascend and descend at the same time. It is impossible to draw your hand with the same hand that is holding the pencil to draw the hand again. So there is a kind of vicious cycle that he creates in terms of perception, and he is extremely intelligent person who has been a kind of a rare example who has applied the paradoxes of art onto representational compositions like this. But then, as I have said, today, after the movement of our art, paintings and sculptures with similar tendency have never stopped. Even today, you can find an umpteen number of works in painting and sculpture, more or less following the same logic of optical illusion and perceptual absurdities or difficulties that our brain and I answer almost every other day. Thank you.